everyone. It is my great, distinctive pleasure to introduce to you Yuval Ron. He is an award-winning composer. He has also entered into the healing field from a scientific point of view. Yuva has been collaborating with neuroscientists, doctors, and healers on developing music and sound that modulate the brainwaves and impact neurological conditions. Yuval's intentional, meditative, and soothing music can improve blood flow in the brain and connectivity in the neural pathways, resulting in reduced pain, improved sleep, trauma recovery, and enhanced memory. And so it's my pleasure to introduce you to Yuval Ron, extraordinary musician, composer, and my personal friend.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Ruth, for this personal and professional introduction. And I'm very happy to be with all of you. I really value deeply your circle based on the work that you do. And I watched, I witnessed your meeting 2 hours last week. And so I feel very much at home with you because I got the idea of what you're about. And I know that you are caring and deep and spiritual people. And so this is a wonderful opportunity to share with you about sound and the brain. And I'd like to start with a little experiment, and I'm gonna use my oud. This is the Melistrian lute. See, it has a belly. This is the grandfather of the guitar and the father of the European lute. It came from the Middle East to Europe in the 8th century. And it's called oud. And what I would like to do is to spend 5 minutes or 6 minutes in sound meditation in order for you to experience the power of sound. And what the exercise is, it will have two parts. The first part, I will play improvised music. I'm going to completely improvise, but I'm doing it intentionally in order to affect your brain. And then in the middle, I will change the music in a certain way and continue to improvise, but in a different way. And what I'd like you to sense is that difference between the first half and the second half. All you need to do is to close your eyes and to focus on the sound. And if images and thoughts coming to you, just acknowledge them. And just look at what you feel and what you think in the first half and in the second half. What kind of senses of temperature you feel in your body, what kind of thoughts you have, sense of location. The music may transport you to another place, what kind of a place it is. And one important thing, I will not announce that I finished first part and I'm going into the second part. I will not let you know. It's just going to be one flow of music. But you will feel that there's a first part and a second part. You will sense it. And then we will do a little circle and see what are the findings. So here we go. Just relax, focus on the music, focus on the sound, enjoy the experience, and just observe your feelings, your sensation, and your thoughts. Here we go. Thank you. Just note how different you feel now than 5 minutes ago. It's just a whole different world of vibrations, of feeling. Isn't that magic? I'm sitting in Studio City, in my studio. You are all over the world. And all I'm doing is I'm choosing certain notes and I'm sending it through the internet. And it reaches your ear and your ear reaches your brain and something magical happened. And it's not a coincidence. Who could tell me, if you could just raise your hand and just unmute and say, what was it like for you in one or two words, the first part of the music and the second part, where we started and where we ended? Colors, feelings, thoughts, locations, temperature, sensation, colors. Who would like to express that in two, three words? And maybe the moderator can help me see.
Yeah, I'll
see
look
everybody.
For sure.
I don't know who would like
I'd
to
start.
Share.
I would
yeah,
start.
Please.
I would think that it was like a snake at first, like just this giant, like cobra coming out of a wicker basket at first, and moved to a beautiful, just this beautiful green and blue stream of flow.
Beautiful, beautiful. Thank you.
And Patricia.
I felt I was a little drop of water in a big waterfall at the first part going down. And then the second part, I was floating in the river.
Beautiful. So we can go on and on and listen to everybody.
Nita has been waving and wanted to share, and nobody noticed.
Thank you, Nita. Go.
Please.
Unmute, though.
The first part was so in such a minor chord, and it was so deeply emotional. And I saw this woman, and she was dancing and moving, and it was like this angst. And then suddenly it just shifted to a mountaintop, and there was a girl twirling in the flowers. It was like I was sitting there going, damn, that worked. Thank you.
That is extraordinary. This is beautiful. And this is happens in every time that I do this experiment with any kind of circle of people from all over around the world. And what is beautiful is that each one of us, our brain makes a different story, a different script. But there's one thing that is common to all the scripts and all the images and all the feelings that all human beings feel is that the first part, there was something dark and limiting and constructing and it can be very dark. And the second half, there's an openness and there's light and there's hope and there's grace and there's a miracle. So it basically, this is a journey from darkness to light. You can interpret it in any kind of personal way. And the beauty is that each one of us has an amazing world of images in us that we use to interpret it in different ways. But it's the same theme of going from darkness to light. And I did it on purpose. I didn't meant to lead you on a journey from light to dark, which I can do. I could do, and sometimes I do. I intended to lead you from the experience of darkness to light. And I did it with music. I didn't tell you anything. There were no words involved. So how can sound affect your feelings, emotions, and thoughts in an intentional way through the internet? I touched your brain. I actually touched your brain and I manipulated your brains to do what I want your brain to do. And that's what I do for a living. I was educated and trained to be a film composer. I studied in Boston in Berklee College of Music. I studied the field of psychoacoustic, which is the psychology of sound, how sound affect our psychology. This is a necessary science that you study if you study to be a film composer. And when a film director tells me, I want the audience to feel afraid now, and then I want the audience to feel hope within 2 minutes. And it doesn't matter how bad or good the script and the acting is, the musician, the composer can make the audience feel what the director wanted them to feel and think, all with sound. So this is just a little demonstration of how powerful sound is. And if sound is so powerful, and if you can intentionally change the way your brain thinks and feels with sound, that means that there's incredible potential for sound as medicine. Because our thoughts and our feelings affect our physiological conditions. And so I'm in the field of writing music for films and television, but I'm also in the field of writing music for doctors and neuroscientists who are using music as a medicine. And today I'd like to explain to you about one product, one kind of music that can impact memory, focus, and concentration. And that is, it's the 40 Hertz sound therapy. But 40 Hertz sound therapy is also involved with brainwaves, which Dr. Steve told us about last time. And that's where it connects very well. So let me share, I'll share a PowerPoint to explain to you more about what's going on here. And we're gonna go to this view. So when I played music to you, there's actually in your brain, scientists are telling us that the impact of sound in the brain is bioelectrical. There's actually biological electrical effect in your brain. It can be measured when sound is being provided to you. There's electrical, biological impact in your brain. Your brain release endorphins, serotonin, dopamine. There's actually chemicals and proteins that are being released in your brain when sound is being sent to you. And different sounds can cause different reactions in your brain. And that's why your brain is actually affecting your physiological body because of those chemicals that are being released in your brain because of the music. And not only that, the most amazing thing is physical structural changes in the brain. So I'm going to stop here because I want to emphasize this. I want to look at you in the eyes and tell you that this is one of the most amazing findings of the neuroscientists that I work with, who documented it in a book called How God Changes Your Brain. How God Changes Your Brain, which is all about how spiritual practices of people from all over the world in all different kind of religions, it doesn't matter what religion they practice, their brains was actually changed when they practice spiritual practice like meditation, prayer, any kind of mindfulness practice over time. Within 3 months, you could see actual structural changes in the brain. So it's not just during the meditation. It's not only during the music that your brain is affected. Actually, there's structural, architectural changes in the brain that last for a long time. If you do that for many years, it lasts for many years. So meditators and musicians have different brain. If you do music, if you meditate for 30 years, your brain is a different brain than if you didn't do it. And it's a healthier brain. It's more resilient. And it's the changes are not lasting for the rest of your life. When there is the end of life, when the brain starts to decline at the very, very end, those changes that you worked on with your mindfulness and your prayers and your meditation and your music making, those changes start to fade out as well. So that's very interesting. What is lost is actually the things that you did as a child. Whatever you did as a child, those are the things, those are the circuits in your brain that are lost. That's why people that suffer from dementia and Alzheimer's, at the very end, they can still recognize a tune from the kindergarten, a little tune that they learn in kindergarten, they will remember more than their children and their wife and husbands, which is so tragic. But music therapists use that knowledge to connect with patients who no longer remember the family, but they can remember the songs that they learned in kindergarten. And the music therapist, a good music therapist, can tap into that in order to create connection, the only connection that can be left. So what we know is that it's an interesting curve that at the end, when the brain really, really deteriorates, even those great achievements that we created in 3 months of meditation or prayer or mindfulness or 30 years of music making and meditation, those achievements last almost to the end. But at the end, even those incredible changes do fade. So let me go back to the presentation. And and I'll show you about the brainwaves that Dr. Steve told us about. Here is a drawing. You see, Dr. Steve told us about the beta waves. Beta waves is where we are right now. We are thinking, we are talking, our brain is analyzing. You see that here on top of the screen, it says beta waves, and that frequency is between 12 cycles to 38 cycles a second, meaning 12 vibrations, 12 pulses. Like imagine 12 pulses a second. It's so fast, it goes do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. I cannot even do it. It's so fast. But look at the drawing. You see the drawing on the top of the page? That is beta waves. That's how our brain vibrate when we are now thinking and listening. Now, if we were to take 10 deep breaths, we will slow down the brain to an alpha wave. Alpha pulsation is 8 pulsations to 12 pulsations a second. That's what 8 to 12 hertz are. And you see the wave here. You see the second wave. That's alpha waves. It's more relaxed. It's not as busy as beta. And that's a beautiful, beautiful altered state of mind. And with music, you can make your brain slow down. And I'm going to show you in the next slides how. You can do that with breathing. You can do it with music. You can slow down your brain to alpha. And that's a very beautiful state because you're awake and you are relaxed. You're calm and alert and awake. Now, if you slow down your brain down to 3 pulsations to 8 pulsations a second, you go into light sleep or meditation or extreme relaxation, and that's called theta waves. And that's a wonderful place where you can write a poem, you can be in a very deep meditative place and write, do creative work, and you're almost like in light sleep. You're so focused, you're so deep in your work that if somebody enters the room, you jump in from your seat and you're so alert because they broke that meditative slow brain pulsation that you were in meditation or creative work. And then if you go to deep sleep, that's the delta waves. And delta waves are the slowest. It's only 2 to 3 pulsations a second. And if you slow down your brain further, you're dead. So that's the slowest you can get. The slowest you can get is delta, and that's deep sleep. So scientists who discovered it thought, you know, maybe we could use music to modulate the brain waves to where we want the brain to be. So if we want to be in meditative state, or if we want to be in sleep state, or we want to be in deep sleep state, or if we want to be awake and calm, we could provide sound to the brain and slow down the brain with slowing the sound. And scientists found that we have this ability to synchronize to whatever pulse we receiving. So binaural beats are one of those techniques for brain entrainment. You put some sound, some pulsations in headphones, and there's one pulse on the right hand, a different pulse in the left hand, and the sum of those, the difference between the pulsation in the right ear and the difference with a pulsation in the left ear, whatever the difference is, that's what your brain starts to synchronize to. And there's actually a third wave that is created in the brain that start to synchronize the brain waves to it. So this is a whole lecture just about binaural beats. I'm rushing through it because, you know, I teach a course of 8 hours, you know, 4 classes of 2 hours each, just about this. So I don't have the time to get into it deeply, but just trust me that there's a way to slow down the brain to those different ranges of alpha, beta, theta, and delta with sound that has pulsation that are in the headphones. Now, it was found that this technique of binaural beats can reduce stress and anxiety. It showed increased focus and concentration and motivation. It improved confidence in some studies. There's long-term memory was improved. It led people to deeper meditation. It enhanced psychomotor performance mood. So these are all benefits that have been shown in studies using binaural beats. Now, here we get to the most, to the heart of my lecture, which is about the 40 Hertz research. So 40 Hertz is not part of beta, it's not part of alpha, it's not part of theta, it's not part of delta. It's actually part of something called gamma, which is faster waves that were relatively recently found. So 40 Hertz is a vibration of 40 pulsation a second. It's very fast. Imagine 40 pulsation in 1 second. It's so fast that it sounds like you don't hear the pulsation, you just hear one tone. It's a low bass note. Now, it was found by researchers at MIT that it's 1 hour a day of 40 Hertz tones per day for 7 days dramatically reduced the amount of beta amyloid in the auditory cortex, which processed sound. Now, this is extraordinary. So let me get out of the share screen so I can impress on you how incredible this is and explain to you this in just normal, simple English. Here's what happened. They worked with mice in the laboratory and they exposed them to sound and light of 40 Hertz, 40 pulsation a second. And what they found that in the brain, there are pathways. And they found in brains of people that had dementia and Alzheimer, that on those pathways, there's some plaque sitting. There's dirt, there's plaque. And it's made from amyloid. That's why it's called amyloid plaque. So that plaque, that dirt, sits on the pathways. And so the information, it's not that you don't remember. You still have the memory, but you cannot process the memory because there's this plaque sitting on the memory pathway, blocking the electrical signals. And so we all have this dirt, this plaque in our pathways, but every human being, when you go to sleep, there's a little cleaning crew that wakes up in the middle of the night where we are all asleep, and that cleaning crew in the brain, the cleaners clean the plaque. It's just a normal cleaning, and now scientists think that has to do with the lymph node. There's all kinds of systems of clearing it out of the brain, but we're not going to get into it. But the point is, our brain just cleans that plaque naturally. But some people in old age, for all kinds of reasons, that cleaning crew just says, that's it. We worked for 50 years. We worked for 60 years. We worked for 70 years, 75 years. Now we are tired. We are on strike. We are retired. We're not working anymore. And what happens is that people start to be unable to access the memory that they have. And they found that this 40 Hertz vibration, it's not that the 40 Hertz vibration cleans that plaque. The magic is that the 40 Hertz vibration wakes up the cleaning crew. that is there but is on strike. The cleaning crew gets this vibration that shakes them up, and they wake up and they realize, hey, we've got some work to do. And they just clean the plaque from the memory pathways, which is incredible magic, magical thing, because it's all sound. It's no drugs, there's no shots, there's no chemo, there's nothing, there's no surgery, there's no side effects, nothing. It's just sound. So the scientists until now I must tell you, I'm very, very fortunate to be on the cutting edge of this science, because I received a call from one of the doctors that is involved with this research. Now, this is so new that if I had this issue with friends and family, and you may have it in your family and friends, that there's somebody who's starting to be on a cognitive decline, and you would take them to the best doctors in America, the best, and these friends and family of mine heard about 40 hertz for me, and they go to the doctor, the best doctor in the world, and they tell them, you know, we heard there's a 40 hertz, should we use it with our mother, should we use it with our father? And the doctor said, I don't know anything about it, forget about it. It's just so new, it's just in research, and there's only few doctors in the world that are actually using it now, because it's still in research. The first study in humans was published last December. So this is so new. It's been going on really actively in the last 5 years. So all the scientists that have been working with that have been using just a tone, which is just that 40 hertz tone, which is just a low note, and light that flashes 40, it turns on and off, on and off, on and off, on and off, 40 times a second. And it's so fast that it looks just like a neon light that goes into your eyes. And imagine sitting there for an hour looking at the light, because the light vibrates through your optical nerve into your brain and vibrate your brain through light and sound, and you hear that annoying based on bzzz, and you sit there for an hour, and that's all that they do, those scientists, and it works. But one of the doctors that is actually using it with patients called me and said, you know, I'm thinking about my patients, and I'm thinking that if we had beautiful music that contained this 40 hertz tone, many more patients will comply. And compliance is so important, to sit there for an hour a day and to do it for years. If we could just have beautiful music that give this sound in it, do you think you could do that? Do you think you could write beautiful music in 40 hertz, with 40 hertz vibrations? And so I said, you know, let me look into it. And I've done a lot of work with binaural beats, which what we talked about before, the sound that can manipulate your brain with music to deeper state of consciousness. And so I looked at 40 hertz, and I found that 40 hertz doesn't exist on the piano. In our current tuning, all the orchestra tuning, all the instruments are tuned to a tuning where 40 hertz would fall in between the white key and the black key in the bass notes of the piano. So in order to create music in 40 hertz, I had to tune all the instruments about a quarter tone lower than normal, which yield a very relaxed tone for the strings of the instruments. And even the singers that sang my 40 hertz music, they felt differently because all the music is a little lower and less tense than the way we tense the strings of the piano and the guitars and all our instruments. So it's about a quarter tone lower, which yield a more mellow, warm tone. And I start composing music in that with where the music includes the tone of 40 hertz, plus there's binaural beats that creates 40 hertz in the brain. And then we looked at studies that show that in music therapy studies in hospitals, in the recovery room, people who listened to the music that the music therapist chose for them, they were released from the hospital faster than the patients that didn't have any music. And they used less drugs for pain relief in the hospital, in the recovery room after surgery. But the third group, you see, the first group had no music. The second group had music that the music therapist, who studied 5 years in the university and knows everything, that music therapy chose the music. The third group, they told the patients to choose their own music, music that they found to be soothing. Each patient chose their own music. They requested any music that they believe that is the most soothing, most beautiful music for them. One patient listened to jazz, one patient listened to classical, one patient listened to vocal music, one patient listened to piano, one patient hates piano, just listened to harp. What they found, that group had even higher success rate as far as using even less painkillers in the recovery room and even getting released from the hospital even earlier than the second group that got the music from the music therapist. And this is one of the, it was done in Scandinavia, that study, and this is a landmark study that showed us that people knows better than the music therapist, that it's a subjective issue. Yes, music can heal, but if the patient prescribed the music, there's greater chance for success. So you are your own healer. You really, if you deeply notice your feeling and reactions to music, you know what works for you. You know what soothes you. You know what irritates you. And you need to choose the remedy in that case, okay? So Dr. Gold, who I'm working on this project, and I'm going to summarize in this, Dr. Gold asked me to create not one album of 40 Hertz music, but a whole catalog of 40 Hertz music in different styles, and we're still working on it. So far, we created soothing jazz ballads for piano and guitar in 40 Hertz. We got choral music, a cappella, beautiful singers singing beautiful soothing music, only voices in 40 Hertz. It's a piece called Heal Me at 40 Hertz. We created a solo classical piano at 40 Hertz. We created world music with Indian music and Persian music instrument, world music in 40 Hertz, and New Age in 40 Hertz. And so I'm going to send a PDF with links to all this music and research and studies and all that. I'm going to send a PDF to, I think I emailed it to Mary Grace. She has it. If I have a second, I can show you that through share screen. But also, yeah, let me just share this document and I'm going to end the talk and be happy to get Q&A. Can you see that document on screen? Okay, so this is what I send Mary Gold, and she'll send it to you, and I can put it in the chat. Look, if you want to learn more about it, I'm doing a retreat. I'm presenting a retreat in LA area near Santa Clarita in a beautiful, beautiful ranch called Sky Oak Ranch. It's a gorgeous place, and it's going to be a weekend in October. It's all going to be about sound and science, and we're actually going to spend 3 days experimenting and singing in 40 Hertz and playing music in 40 Hertz and doing movement and music that all, this is experiential retreat. And also we're going to learn a lot about the science. It's all about sound and the brain. I invite you all to come to that incredible weekend, October 25th, 27th. You have a link here. Now, here's the music. The 40 Hertz soothing jazz ballads, you have a link. You have the 40 Hertz choral music. You have the classical piano. You have the world music and the new age. And for sleep, that's not 40 Hertz. 40 Hertz is not for sleep. There's delta is the wavelength, the slowest brainwave is delta. And this is a new album that just came out last week called Deep Sleep, with beautiful music, with binaural beats for sleep. And here there are links for more info. This is my email. You're welcome to send me an email anytime with any questions. That's my website. This is the website of Meta with double T, Meta Mindfulness Music. And I'm gonna put all this in the chat so you can see it in the chat, but you're gonna get it through email as well. So if you'd like to ask me any question about this, I'll be happy to answer.
Yes, I have a Patricia.
I was wondering, in YouTube, there are videos with binaural sounds.
Yes.
Patricia, can you speak up?
I'm sorry, I have it down. In YouTube, there are videos with binaural sounds. And
yes.
But it's coming from a computer. Does it, if I'm not wearing a headphone, would it go the right hertz to the right ear and the right number of hertz in the left ear?
I mean, so what happens is for binaural beats, there are different kinds of brain entrainment, and that's something that I teach in my retreats and courses. Binaural beats is one kind of brain entrainment. There's other kinds of beats, but binaural beats require that you use headphones. That's number one. You have to use the headphones. Now, another issue is that the sound from YouTube is low quality MP3. It's not ideal. It still can work if you use headphones, but you don't get the full amount of vibrations. And on Meta Mindfulness Music, on every page of that website, on the top, there's a link to a video that explains why downloading wave files or getting the CD is better than listening to streaming sound, which is all the streaming sounds that you hear from YouTube and MP3. They reduce the amount of vibrations in order to stream it. So that's like watered down. It's like imagine you have Tylenol and you add half water to it and you drink the Tylenol. It's going to work a little bit, but it's watered down. It's better to get the full amount of sound vibrations.
Thank you.
And then Ruth, you had a question or a comment?
Yeah, you talked about the implications of manipulation.
Right.
It occurred to me, why can't we use this in a widespread way to create world peace, for heaven's sake? If we know that, if we have all these towers now, 5G towers around the world, why can't we be transmitting 40 hertz from the towers? Because it's incredible. And one last comment. In Judaism, the idea is that God spoke the world into existence, and now I understand why.
It's all vibration.
But it was all through the vibration of sound that that the earth was created, rather than
Right. Yeah. In many traditions, in the Hindu tradition, also the world was created with sound. And sound is very fundamental for all universe. And there's a saying in Hinduism, nada brahma, nada brahma. Brahma is creation, nada is sound. Creation is sound. It's all sound vibration. About peace, there was a group in San Francisco, a nonprofit organization that started to promote having music in every political conference, every diplomatic meeting, and the leaders really needs that. And the concept was that it will lower the tension. And so imagine if we could take all the leaders and every meetings and get them into alpha state, where they are awake, but they are calm, rather than they are aggressive. So this is a very interesting project. I wish we could send those waves all over the world to calm people and to transfer their mindset to a more peaceful vibration. Right. Let's go to another.
Okay, the next Nitzan? Yes.
Nitzan. Hi, Yuval.
Hello.
Thank you. I really resonate with this. I just want to make a comment. When you played the music, I started crying right away. I felt the pain. And then there was an opening and my lower back and belly got very warm. and with a lot of energy. So I really resonated with that. And I teach healing movement. I'm actually going to do something with the group. I really love that we heal ourselves. That place where I use my own voice. So that's my question. I have a cat, so we purr together.
Yeah. Oh, that's very healing. Yeah.
So yeah, that's what. So
very
that
calming.
So would it be good to play with different tones?
Certainly. Yeah. Yeah. You need to find the tone that vibrates to you best, and it has to do with your body mass, your structure of bones, your everything. And another person in the group. You see, when I teach using the voice, chanting, and using sound meditation, using the voice, I always tell my students, you know, you need to find your tone, not my tone. So do what I'm doing, but do it in the tone that you feel vibrating in the organ or the area of the body that we are working on. So it's very subjective. There are some tones that are given to us by certain traditions, like our Veda. There's a certain practices that you have to take the tone from a music instrument that is associated with the chakra or associated with the dosha, etc. So, but the working with the voice is incredibly important. And in this retreat that I'm doing in October, a lot of the work, a lot of it will have to do with breathing and vocalizing. And you don't have to be a singer. Like you said, you know, our cats do those vocals. Mm-hmm. They're not singers. So we can all do that.
Right. Thank you.
And Carolyn, I think you were next, and then Melanie, and we've got about 4 minutes left to wrap up.
Okay. Thank you so much for this wonderful presentation, sir. And I just wondered if you had heard of Stephen Halpern.
Yes, I've been in touch with Stephen. Yeah, yeah, he's one of my colleagues, and we worked on a album together. He wanted me to play on some of his music, and we did some sessions. Yeah, I know him. Yeah.
Well, thank you.
Yeah.
Melanie.
So I just have a kind of a weird question. I had listened to gone to your website when this was posted. You were going to have this presentation for us. I'm really excited about it. And I listened to what was available on your website, just really very healing listening to that. My weird question, it occurs to me, the place I listen to music the most often is in my car. And what, you know, is there a hertz for driving, for stimulating and keeping your mind busy? Is there, something you recommend for that? Because that's really where I always have music.
Yes. Well, it's a great place to listen to music in the car. And it's best if you could listen to CDs, if you still have CD players, or listen to the radio. The radio would be better than listening to Spotify or YouTube, but if you don't have any other way and you listen to YouTube or Spotify or Apple Music on the car, it's good. What you need is music that is soothing and calming and relaxing. You don't want to be overstimulated. So very aggressive music can make your driving aggressive. I saw a video one time of American tank teams in the Gulf, in Iraq, inside the tank, they are in war, and they're listening to heavy metal because, you know, and they're driving the tank, and they are very aggressive, and they like that music, and it makes them very aggressive, and they feel that that's what they need. It's very bad for their brain. It has very bad impacts beyond that situation. But, you know, you could use it to invigorate a football team. You can use that aggressive music to invigorate a sports team or a military team before and during action. But that's exactly what you don't want to listen to when you driving. So you choose the right music and listen to it in the car. It's a very good place. Let's go to the next
okay, question. Patricia.
I read that humming is good for you. Mm. If you
yes.
can tell why, like for instance, when we say om, the more emphasis should be done in the am, not in the o.
Yeah, you know, there's a whole teaching. I'm actually doing a retreat in the Bahamas in January that is focused on that in the Shivananda Ashram in the Bahamas. It's all this retreat in January 10th to 15th. It's all about chanting Om, and our according to the Ayurvedic tradition, Om has four different sounds, and there's different medical benefits for emphasizing different sounds. The M is one of them. It's only one, and you need to know which one to use when. It's really a medicine, and the vibration of the humming is very good because it gives you an internal massage. So humming is very good, and it depends on the frequency of the humming, but it's a great tool.
Vitamin C has biotin 6 pills. No, seriously, these things are packed. Forbes call.
I don't know. Okay, and Nadia, last question, and then we will wrap up with this beautiful presentation.
Yeah, quick question. Have you heard of the sound from like the sun and out of space? And I'm just curious what your thoughts are compared to the music that you put out as far as the healing capabilities.
Yeah, there's all kinds of frequencies that coming to us from the planets. So there's different vibrations from different planets. And we are in the middle of a soup of electrical sounds, electrical vibrations that come from space all the time. You know, we don't know yet exactly which sound is which, and, you know, exactly what is the frequency of Venus and exactly what the frequency of that planet or that planet, but there are a lot of frequencies going on. We assume that the natural frequencies that humanity have been exposed to for billions and billions and billions of years, the natural frequencies of the planet are good for our development, and all the frequencies of the cell phones, for example, are very destructive for us because they are new and they are not organic, they're not natural. And they may have damaging impact on us, you know, the frequencies from cell phone towers and cell phones and all the vibrations that we have. But we are experiencing everything, all the planets, the sun, the vibrations of planet Earth. We are in the midst of incredible soup of vibrations, and it's very complex. And what we know is that the sunlight is very healthy for us, but not in too much. And it can be that the same thing with sound. You know, if you're exposed to direct sun, you receive vibrations that can be good for a limited time. If you're staying in the sun too long, it can be damaging for our skin and for our health. So it's all about, you know, like medicine, it's all about dosage, how much. It can be toxic. If you take something really good too much, it becomes toxic. So it's the same with all the vibrations.
Thank you so much, Yuval. I'm not meaning to cut you off. We have 4 minutes left, and please come back, and Mary Grace will most likely send out all of those links and in ways to get in touch with you, and a big round of astounding applause.
Thank you. Thank you, my friends. Thank you for having
vibration.
Me.